Evening, everybody. Hope everybody's doing well, had dinner. Not going to fall asleep because you had too much dinner or anything. My name is Michael Lord. I'm the site director here at Philipse Manor Hall State Historic Site. I want to welcome you to our third session in our lecture series this year. And for Women's History Month, we are presenting She Merchants, Sachems, and Slaves, Women in Colonial New York. Want to just give you a brief introduction to the two presenters that we have today. Very thrilled indeed. Sarah Wassberg Johnson is the Education Programs Manager here at Philipse Manor Hall State Historic Site. She has a master's degree in public history from the University of Albany, also has a BA in history from Concordia College. And for about 10 years, Sarah was director of exhibits, outreach, education. She wore many, many hats at the Hudson River Maritime Museum in Kingston. She is also the food historian, should anybody happen to find her online or in her blog. She's very good at what she does, and I'm thrilled to have her here. Also, Danna Cruz, she is one of our museum interpreters here at Philipse Manor Hall. Currently, Danna is also working on her master's degree in museum studies from Johns Hopkins University in Baltimore. She also has a BA in liberal studies at SUNY Purchase and has interned at places like the Neuberger Museum as well as New York Botanical Gardens. So I'm thrilled to have the two of them here presenting today. Again, She Merchants, Sachems, and Slaves, Women of Colonial New York. Ladies.
Michael. Hi, everybody in person and online. Just bear with me for a minute while we share our screen here. I'm Sarah, by the way. You'll be seeing Danna shortly. Okay, put myself up here in the corner. Put this down in the corner. All right. So tonight's talk is She Merchants, Sachems, and Slaves, Women in Colonial New York. I'm Sarah Wassberg Johnson. Danna Cruz will be joining us shortly. We're tag teaming today, so thank you for your patience as we switch back and forth. Oh, let me do the clicky. Here we go. All right, so tonight our topic is all about women in Colonial New York. We're gonna be talking about three major groups. Indigenous women were here for thousands of years before European contact. In New York, the groups we're going to be talking tonight are largely the Munsee Lenape, who were in the Hudson Valley, the Mohicans, and the women of the six Confederated Iroquois nations, the Mohawk, Oneida, Onondaga, Cayuga, Seneca, and Tuscarora. Our second group we'll be discussing are African and African-descended women who are also present in Colonial New York, mostly brought here against their wills in the bondage of slavery. In New York, the majority of enslaved people were of Akan or Bakongo cultural descent. And finally, we wouldn't be a colony if there weren't colonizers. So we'll also be discussing women in Dutch New Netherlands, English New York, and women of other European backgrounds. So for this first section, I am going to turn it over to Danna. So please welcome Danna Cruz.
Thank you, Sarah. Thank you, Michael. It's a pleasure to be here. So the first group we will be talking about is women in the Munsee country. This is something I can relate to because I myself am indigenous from the southwest of Mexico. So our first group of women are women in the Munsee country. Munsee women foraged for food, took care of children, cooked, weaved, participated in field work, hunting, and trapping game. Munsee women also participated in commercial exchanges on behalf of Munsee men. They had their own accounts with Dutch colonists, so they can exchange the fur pelts like beaver for textiles and other European goods. Munsee clans were matrilineal, and matrilocal, which meant that men would marry into a woman's tribe. It was a community where wealth was distributed equally and where patriarchal tendencies were discouraged. Munsee women could also become sachem or leader of their tribe. That's where Mamanushka comes in. She's a female sachem for the Esopus tribe who defied gender roles. She was also known as Strong Woman or Mama Riach, excuse me. The Esopus people lived northwest of the Hudson River, known today as Ulster County. Robert Grummet writes, Mamanushka and other women strode late 17th century diplomatic floorboards as full-fledged sachems, signing treaties and selling land. Our next group is women in Iroquois. The Iroquois women were regarded as important figures in their tribe. Like Munsee women, however, this changed with the advent of colonization when the Iroquois adopted a colonial outlook, so much that the Iroquois men started to insult Munsee men by calling them women. Excuse me. Roles of women were also minimized. Iroquoian clan mothers worked more discreetly, quietly, meeting among themselves to select and remove kinsmen as leaders. Odronchu was one of several documented non-Confederacy Iroquoian female leaders. She was known as the Queen of Conestoga. Our next group of women is women in New Netherlands. Many of the women arriving to the new colony were educated because in the Netherlands, girls were offered access to primary education, the same as boys. The Dutch brought these same practices to the colony. Dutch women also had rights to own land, the right to participate in any business, the right to have a separate will from their husband, prenuptial agreements, and the right to sue a man for child support if she was unmarried and pregnant with his child. Women who participated in trade were called she merchants. Women in the Netherlands had marital rights that stated that women had the right to choose between being under the guardianship of her husband, Manus, or retain all the rights she had as a single woman, usus, which recognized both parties as equal. If a woman chose manus or guardianship, she was not held legally responsible for her husband's actions, especially with business dealings. If she chose usus or equal partnership, she and her husband were legally responsible for each other's actions. Next up, we have Margaret Hardenbrook, who's also the lady of the house. Margaret was a she merchant, and by the age of 22, she sailed for the new colony on a ship with no chaperone, which was acceptable among the Dutch, to collect debt and engage in trade on behalf of her cousin, Wouter Vlok. She came from a family of merchants involved in global trade. Her expertise in writing, arithmetic, and trading would go on to help her establish a reputation as the wealthiest woman in New Netherland with half of Westchester to her name. Margaret marries Peter de Vry in 1659, and they have a daughter named Maria. Peter dies in 1661, and Margaret inherits his assets, some of which she uses to expand her fleet of ships. She then meets and marries Frederick Philipse by 1662. Frederick formally adopts Maria and changes her name to Ava. They find success in the fur trade with houses in New York City and Albany. In 1672, they acquired this property from Adrian Vanderdonk's widow and began to use it as a trading post. By the 1680s, the fur trade is becoming less profitable. In 1685, they send their first ship, the Charles, to West Africa to engage in the slave trade. Margaret dies in 1691. Up next, we have Woman in British New York. So New Netherland was conquered by the British in 1664. Although the Dutch were allowed to keep many of the traditions, English law resulted in Dutch women losing most of their legal rights. In her own lifetime, Margaret Hardenbrooke went from being an equal partner to the legal property of her husband, Frederick. Under English law, women considered femme covert when they married. When they married, they became legally indistinct from their husbands. The law treated them as one person with a husband in charge. Women surrendered control over property upon marriage and could not enter contracts, write wills, keep wages, or initiate legal action without consent or participation of their husbands. Women were expected to obey their husband and focused on domestic chores and household management. Women were not allowed to hold public office, and were not allowed to vote or be a witness in a legal case. Men were legally allowed to beat their wives, and only men could sue for divorce or file for an annulment. In those instances, the father always retained guardianship of any children. British law did allow women more legal rights in one instance, widowhood. Upon her husband's death, if they had no male children, or the eldest male child was not yet of age, a widow could own and control property and assets, essentially serving as regent to her son's life. Upon his reaching majority, all of the assets went to the eldest son, including responsibility for the care of his mother. Girls' inheritance were held in trust until they came of age or married. Widows without male children gained the most freedom. Without a husband to cover her under coverture, a widow regained her legal personhood. I'll let Sarah take over.
Thank you. Although I noticed we have this weird thing that I'm just going to move out of the way. Okay. Oh, yes, we did have one. I added this portrait of a British family from 1758 because I thought it really illustrated the British form of law about kind of the hierarchy of the family, right? So we have this very wealthy aristocratic man here, and his wife is below him, and then their two female children are below her. So it's kind of like a literal representation of British domestic life, right? So our next group is women in Africa. Most enslaved people in New York came from Western Africa. And although today the stereotype of Africa is of a powerless, largely rural or tribal place, this stereotype is a product of 19th century colonization. In the 16th and 17th centuries, Western Africa was dominated by powerful kingdoms and empires vying for land and resources, much like Europe. The Gold Coast was an area of West Africa that combined many unique but related kingdoms, today known as Ghana. Most of the groups in Ghana were Akan. The Dahomey and Asante people were distinct subsets of the Akan cultural group. In Southwest Africa, we had several powerful kingdoms in modern-day Congo and Angola, including some which were ruled by a queen. These areas are also the primary both purveyors of enslaved people in the slave trade and also sources of enslaved people in the slave trade with Europe. The Gold Coast was home to several kingdoms, including the Asante and Dahomey kingdoms. They were all part of a Akan culture. Sorry, this keeps moving and it's bothering me. Which was matrilineal and included avenues for women in leadership and warrior roles. The Asante Empire, also known as the Ashanti Empire, was located in modern-day Ghana and lasted from 1701 to 1901. The neighboring kingdom of Dahomey is perhaps most famous for its women warriors. Located in present-day Benin, Dahomey lasted from around 1600 to 1904. Highly militaristic, Dahomey became involved in the European slave trade, selling captives from neighboring nations in exchange for European goods, including firearms. Dahomey is perhaps best known for the Dahomey Amazons, a group of female warriors who were formed sometime in the mid-1600s, likely in response to the depopulation of the male military. By the 18th century, they were bodyguards to Queen Hongbe, and although many other Akan cultures had women warriors, the Dahomey Amazons, are among the first and only to be documented to be frequently used in battle and deployed as an official arm of the military. So this is a photo from 1793, an illustration from 1793 depicting, it says, armed women, which is what all of these people here, you can see they have muskets with them. These are all women, with the king at their head going to war. This is another amazing image. These are Dahomey warriors in Paris in 1891, clearly visiting and kind of showing off their culture. The Dahomey Amazons remained a serious military force until the early 20th century. And they have gone on to inspire modern day incarnations, such as 2022's The Woman King, which is a fictionalized account of their history. And my personal favorite, the fictional Dora Milaje, an elite all women guard tasked with protecting the fictional king of Wakanda. In Southwest Africa, we was also home to a number of powerful nations, all of whom were involved in the slave trade. The Kingdom of Congo, which lasted from around 1390 to 1862, was located in the present-day northern Angola, DRC, and Republic of Congo. The kingdoms of Ndongo and Matava were located in present-day Angola. And Luanda, today the capital of present-day Angola, was one of the oldest and largest slave trading ports in Southwest Africa. The Portuguese established a slave trading station there in 1530. In the 17th century, both Ndongo and Matava were ruled by a queen. Nzinga Mbande, also known as Anna de Souza, ruled as the queen of the Mbunda kingdoms of Ndongo and Matava, located in present-day northern Angola, from the 1620s until her death in 1663. Trained as a warrior and politician, she took control of the kingdom of Ndongo after the deaths of her father and brother and went on to conquer the neighboring nation of Matava. She was often at odds with her powerful neighbor, the Kingdom of Congo. She spoke fluent Portuguese and served as an ambassador to Portugal during her brother's bloody reign, which came in handy as the European nation tried to flex its muscles in Western Africa. As part of peace negotiations, she offered to be publicly baptized and was given the Christian name Anna de Souza after her godparents. Her relationship with the Portuguese was rocky, however. In the 1620s, they tried to overthrow Nzinga and place their own puppet ruler on the throne. In order to defeat them, she became a warrior queen and appointed an all-women bodyguard. By the 1630s, she had established trade relations with the Kingdom of Congo and the Dutch, actively participating in the lucrative slave trade. In the 1650s, after two decades of war, Nzinga and the Portuguese finally made peace. Worried about succession, she named her sister Kamba her heir, and when Nzinga died in 1663, her sister took over the throne. This image depicts a famous story about Nzinga when she is meeting in Luanda with the Portuguese to sue for peace, essentially. And they don't provide her a chair. And also, a lot of African leaders, when meeting with the Europeans, they would dress in European-style dress. And you can't see it super well in this image. But she is sitting on one of her servants. A person is being her chair. And she is not dressed in European dress because essentially she was proud of her cultural heritage and did not consider herself inferior to Europeans. And that became a big part of the peace negotiations, was that she did not really have to be subjugated by the Portuguese. So this next section, we are including a content warning. The following slides do contain descriptions and images of violence against women. So if anybody needs to step out or step away, please feel free. We're gonna be talking about this for about 10 minutes. But I just wanted to let everybody know because some of the images might be a little shocking. And I'm gonna hand this section over to Danna.
Slavery in New York begins in 1626 with the Dutch West India Company, legally ends in 1827 and continues in practice thanks to gradual manumission until the 1840s. Enslaved women are perhaps among the most archivally obscure of all the women we will be discussing today. Because they were considered property in colonial America, their names and lineages were rarely recorded. When they are recorded at all, it is often in wills and inventories. Sometimes they are listed just by their race and gender, sometimes an age. Other times they are listed by first name or by their job, lady's maid, cook, nursemaid. Some of the most complete records we have of these women is from runaway slave advertisements. Because they were legally considered property and not people, enslaved women endured some of the most traumatic bodily violence, including sexual assault and rape, which brings us to the next point. As white Europeans were developing the institution of slavery, they quickly realized the legal complications of sexual violence against enslaved women. If an enslaved woman bore a child by a white father, was that child white or black, free or enslaved? European inheritance law was patrilineal, as slavery was codified to avoid freeing mixed-race children. It became matrilineal. Regardless of who the father was, any child born to an enslaved woman was automatically enslaved. European gender roles applied in some ways to enslaved women, but not others. For instance, many enslaved women were used as nannies and wet nurses for the children of their enslavers. But unlike white women, they were often still expected to do the hardest physical labor of agricultural work, especially on sugar plantations. Where labor was not segregated by gender, because they so often were tasked with caring for other women's children, they were often apart from their own families. Family separation was often the rule, not the exception, in colonial New York. Most enslavers did not want their slaves to form family units. Children were separated from their parents and tasked with learning adult labor as young as 6 years old. Families could be sold away from each other at any time. Enslaved people were not legally allowed to marry, and often husbands and wives were enslaved by different Europeans.
These next images depict some of the common bodily violence against enslaved women. The first depicts an instance of a young girl, about 14 years old, being whipped for refusing to dance naked for the sailors aboard a slave ship. Enslaved women were frequently raped and used for sex on long slave ship voyages. But because they were not always kept chained in the hold like the men, some women were able to foment rebellions on board slave ships. This particular image is published in 1792, and it basically caused so much outrage about this that the captain, Captain Kimber, depicted not very flatteringly here, was brought up on charges in England, but ended up being acquitted of all charges. That image and this image were part of an effort to abolish slavery in New York. This image depicts two enslaved people being whipped while a white woman watches. And the inclusion of women in these images is really to try to appeal to the patriarchal gender sensibilities of Britain at the time, that women should not be treated the same as men, but enslaved women often were. So these two images are both published in 1792 as part of a movement to abolish the slave trade in Britain. Ultimately, the 1792 Abolition Act fails, and it takes several more years for abolition to come to England. However, as Danna was talking about, as Europeans are figuring out what slavery means and codifying slavery, in the early years, there was still some wiggle room, right? So when the Netherlands was first founded, indentured servitude was the rule of the day for finding cheap labor. But the Dutch West India Company very quickly turned to slavery. In 1626, the capture of a Portuguese ship as a prize included 11 African men, several of whom were Akan. Although it is unclear whether or not they were already enslaved, the Dutch West India Company quickly claimed ownership of them and set them to work clearing forests, constructing buildings, and fortifications. Eventually, they and other enslaved people were offered freedom in exchange for military service. Right, this is under Governor Kieft during Kieft's War, the Peachtree War, Esopus Wars. This is happening from the 1630s really until the 1650s. And they simply did not have enough people to serve in the military. So this is why enslaved people are offered freedom in exchange for military service. Freedom in quotes, by the way. Because slavery was not yet codified, many of these first 11 and other of the first enslaved people in New Netherland successfully argued for both wages and their eventual freedom, usually through military service. After 18 years of service, these first 11, including their wives, were granted a conditional half freedom. They were granted land north of the wall, which here's the wall, which is today Wall Street, so north of the wall in Manhattan. In return, they paid an annual tax. Failure to pay the tax would result in their re-enslavement, and notably, their children were not enslaved with them. Or sorry, were not freed with them. Their children remained enslaved. Of the first farms awarded in 1634, two of them were to widows, Catalina Anthony and Marika widow of Lawrence. The land of the blacks continued to grow for about 10 years when the land awards ceased. Although it survived the changes in colonial government from Dutch to English, the pressures on its free black residents became too much. By 1702, new slave codes prohibited people of African descent, free or not, from inheriting property. And we have another example from this early period.
Elizabeth Key was born in 1630 in Warwick County, Virginia, the daughter of an enslaved woman and a free Englishman. She was left in the care of her godfather to be indentured for 9 years and then freed. However, when she was 10, Key was transferred to Colonel Moultrie. She met a male indentured servant and they had a child. Once Moultrie died, the next of kin to the colonel assumed Key and her son were enslaved. She then went on to challenge the court system in Virginia in 1655 for her freedom and her son's freedom, and lost. However, she appealed to the General Assembly, who found that by the common law, the child of a woman's slave begot by a free man ought to be free. On the strength of that ruling, Key appealed the case and won. However, a little over a decade later, the General Assembly changed the law so that other enslaved people could not argue for their freedom like Elizabeth. Historian Jennifer Morgan writes that kinship posed danger to an economy in which race demarcated human beings as property.
Thank you, sir. You're welcome. Okay. As we have learned, women in a con culture have a long history of warrior training. Many enslaved Akan people were also called Coromantes in the period. Named for Coromantine Castle, one of the many island fortifications in West Africa built to hold enslaved Africans for shipment overseas, Coromante was often used to describe Akan people with warrior training or characteristics. Akan women who were enslaved often used their leadership and warrior training to foment rebellion. Throughout the enslavement in the Americas, enslaved people rebelled. Some ran away, some resisted in other, more subtle ways. But the one method of resistance white enslavers feared the most was the uprising. Of the many slave rebellions of the 17th and 18th century, we know of two that were led by women. In 1716, an enslaved cook named Maria was accused of masterminding a rebellion in the Dutch-held Caribbean island of Curaçao. On September 15, 1716, the enslaved revolted. Several white staff, including women and children, were killed. An enslaved man named Trump accused Maria after extensive torture. He claimed she wanted revenge on the plantation's overseer who had killed her husband. Although she maintained her innocence, Maria was burned alive for her crimes on November 9th, 1716. Oh my gosh, I keep switching that around. In the 1830s, a woman known as Queen Nanny or Granny Nanny was the leader of the Windward Maroons in Jamaica. Nanny was Asante from Ghana, and she may or may not have been enslaved at one point. The Maroons were self-emancipated Africans who escaped slavery and lived in the mountains of Jamaica. For decades, they engaged in guerrilla warfare to overthrow the British colonizers. In 1730, an influx of British troops were sent to subdue Nanny and the Windward Maroons. The British were defeated over and over again. Each year, new regiments would be sent and would lose. The place where the Windward Maroons were headquartered was called Nanny Town, after Queen Nanny. Unable to defeat the Maroons, the British began brokering peace in 1739. In 1740, Queen Nanny was among the Maroon leaders who signed peace treaties with the British Crown. Although the treaties ended the fighting and allowed the Maroons to keep their territories, the treaties also forced them to acknowledge the institution of slavery. Queen Nanny is today known as one of the founders of Jamaica. She is featured on their $500 note, which are affectionately called Nannies, much like the US $100 banknotes are called Benjamins, after Benjamin Franklin. Bear with me. New York had one documented major uprising. In 1711, the first slave market was established in New York. And in the spring of 1712, enslaved Africans, many of whom were Cormanti, decided to overthrow their enslavers. They planned to set fires and kill any of the white colonists who came to put them out. They set one fire and killed 8 white colonists and injured another 6 before they were stopped. In the hysteria afterwards, in which 70 enslaved people were arrested and accused, of those, 4 women were ultimately tried. Amba, an Akan woman enslaved by Adolph Phillips, Lily, enslaved by John Crook, Abigail, enslaved by Gaisbert Vandenberg, and Sarah, enslaved by Stoffel Pels. Although Amba and Lily were discharged, both Abigail and Sarah were sentenced to death. Sarah was pregnant at the time, so they held her in jail until she gave birth, and then executed her. 25 people were ultimately executed for the crime. 21, including Abigail and Sarah, were hanged. 3 were burned at the stake, and 1 man was broken on the wheel. Sarah was the last to die. In the spring of 1741, a series of fires in Manhattan called to mind the insurrection of 1712, and white New Yorkers panicked, convinced that the enslaved population was colluding with poor whites to overthrow and murder the ruling class. Hundreds of enslaved people were arrested, questioned, and tried. 16-year-old white indentured servant Mary Burton was at the center of it all. Indentured to tavern owner John Hewson, she testified that Hewson, along with the free and enslaved blacks, had conspired to set the fires and murder the ruling class. I should note that no white people were actually murdered as a result of these fires. Mary was pressured to testify by officials and reveal more names or end up in jail herself. The conspiracy also reflected a general unease about lower class whites and free and enslaved blacks mixing socially. Hewson's tavern sold alcohol to the black population, and it was a popular meeting spot. One woman implicated by Mary Burton was Margaret Sabero, also called Peggy Terry. Peggy was a prostitute who black men often patronized. She was also in a relationship with Caesar, one of the enslaved accused ringleaders, and had a child by him. Sarah Hewson, John Hewson's wife, was also implicated by Burton. The Hewsons and Peggy Carey were hanged on June 12, 1741, but the prosecutions and confessions continued. Mary Burton, who continued to provide names and testimony, was ultimately relieved of the burden of her indenture by the death of her master. She even received payment for her testimony. What ultimately becomes of her is unknown, but by the end of the trials, 30 blacks and 4 whites were executed. Most were hanged, but 17 black men were burned at the stake. 70 blacks and 7 whites were deported. Most of the enslaved were deported to even worse conditions in the Caribbean. And again, I will note that no white person was killed in these fires. This is all just hysteria around this conspiracy. As we get into the second half of the 18th century, we start to approach the revolution. So we're going to talk a little bit about that. The revolution was in many ways a civil war. relatives and friends often found themselves on opposite sides of the conflict. And although many New Yorkers were patriots determined to win their independence, many were loyal to the British crown and sought to defend their government from being overthrown. The Hudson Valley was a major site of battles and conflicts for the duration of the war from 1776 until Evacuation Day in November of 1783. Westchester County in particular, especially the Philipse Manor through which the Albany Post Road ran and whose Kingsbridge connected Manhattan to the mainland, became a sort of neutral zone in which British regulars and American Continentals routinely fought, and loyalist and patriot militias and vigilantes ran roughshod over the local populace. Many loyalist men left their wives in disputed territories in an effort to maintain their claims to their lands. Loyalist men living in patriot communities were often targets of violence, sometimes fatal violence. And although they hoped that their wives' gender would protect them from violence, loyalist women who stayed also faced violence. Of the men who joined both militaries, many were poor and their wives unable to survive without access to their husband's military pay. Without men to do the heavy work of farm labor or crafts, these women pulled up stakes and followed the army. Some survived alongside their husbands. Some took on laundry to make ends meet. Some women followed the army as prostitutes or widows, or as widows offering cooking and laundry to keep themselves fed and clothed. When the American army was encamped at New Windsor over the winter of 1781 to 1782, as many as 5,000 women and children camped with them. Women also served as spies for both sides. Lone women in the countryside, although potential prey for criminals and rogue military, were also not an uncommon sight during this period. Working in taverns, traveling as midwives, marketing goods, they were often suspected less frequently than lone men. Many women hoped that the revolution would bring them more legal rights. Abigail Adams, who's pictured here, was married to founding father John Adams and famously asked him to, quote, remember the ladies when writing the Constitution. Alas, he replied, I cannot help but laugh. The British legal system of couverture would remain in place in the new nation for decades. So we've talked a lot about British and Dutch women, but they were not the only women present in New York in this period. Rebecca Gomez belonged to the Gomez family, which are very early Jewish immigrants to New Netherlands and New York. The Gomez family escaped the Spanish Inquisition in the early 1600s and eventually settled in New Netherlands. By the 1770s, Rebecca Gomez, along with her family, were successful merchants in New York City. Rebecca herself owned and operated a chocolate manufactory, making the popular drinking chocolate, not eating, drinking, and selling other sundries. The Gomez family were among the first Jewish settlers in New York, and Gomez Mill House in Marlborough, New York, is the oldest Jewish structure in America still standing. So this is an advertisement from the 18th century. I don't have an exact date on this, but she is advertising tea and sugar, coffee, pepper, ginger, citron, all kinds of other things, including own manufactured chocolate, warranted. Right, free from any sediments and pure. And then there's another advertisement. This one is specifically from 1780, so she is continuing to operate through the American Revolution, and it's advertising her chocolate manufacturer in New York City, which was by this time held by the British. So we don't know if she was loyal or patriot. Maybe she was neutral, but I just found that date interesting. We also have some of our Philipse family women now. Susanna Philipse Robinson was the eldest daughter of Frederick Philipse II. She married Virginia Planter's son, Beverly Robinson, in 1747. And when her father died in 1751, she was allotted sections of the Highland Patent, also known as the Philipse patent, which is today Putnam County. When her sister Margaret died, the patent was divided between the remaining heirs, Philip Phillips, Susanna, and her younger sister, Mary Phillips. Her eldest brother, Frederick III, inherited the rest of the Phillips Manor. Susanna's share was approximately 50,000 acres. And in 1758, she and her husband, Beverly, built a house they called Beverly House on a 1,500-acre estate along the Hudson River, opposite West Point in what is today Phillips Town in Dutchess County. In 1776, when war broke out, Susanna retreated to Phillips Manor Hall to stay with her brother, Frederick III, and her younger sister, Mary. Beverly Robinson commanded Loyalist troops in Westchester, including Black Loyalists, throughout the war. In 1777, Susanna fled with her siblings to New York City. Beverly House became the headquarters of American General Benedict Arnold, and was where he plotted his failed treason. In 1779, the Robinson holdings in Putnam County were confiscated with the Act of Attainder. The Robinsons fled to England in 1783. Beverly House passed through many hands before it burned down in 1892. So Susanna has a connection to our next woman. Oh, so I'll talk about, this is the Phillips patent. So you can see there's Susanna, Mary, and Phillips, and then the other two sections were divided so that everybody would have access to the Hudson River. And this is the section that gets Susanna and Beverly in a little bit of trouble here. So our next colonial woman is Mehitabel Prendergast, Mehitabel Wing Prendergast. A New England Quaker, Mehitabel Wing married William Prendergast and moved into what they thought was an unclaimed portion of the oblong, disputed territory between Connecticut and New York in the 1750s. They paid rent to the Wappinger Indians, led by Daniel Ninham. But unbeknownst to them, the property had been claimed decades earlier by Adolph Phillips. And upon his death and the death of his nephew, Frederick Phillips II, it was divided among the Phillips heirs, Philip Phillips, Susanna Phillips Robinson, and her husband, Beverly Robinson, and Mary Phillips. The Prendergasts lived in a section claimed by the Robinsons. When Beverly and Susanna imposed shorter leases and raised the rents, the Prendergasts and other neighboring tenants revolted. Hundreds marched down to New York City, where the governor accused them of treason and sent out the militia. Although the tenant farmers escaped, William Prendergast was captured and tried as one of the leaders of the farmers. Mehitabel ended up defending him in court, where the prosecution accused her of using her good looks to influence the jury. The Prendergasts ultimately lost their court case, and William was sentenced to death. But Mehitabel was not done. She rode 80 miles to try to secure a pardon, which she did. Fed up with manor lords, she and William pulled up stakes and moved west, eventually settling in Ohio. Sorry, and I did not do any of those bullet points. Donna's turn.
Our next colonial woman is Phyllis Wheatley. Kidnapped at the age of 7 or 8 in Africa and sold into slavery in 1761, Phillips Wheatley was enslaved by the Wheatley family of Boston and named for the slave ship which had brought her to Massachusetts. She had been purchased for John Wheatley's wife, Susanna. Their children, Mary and Nathaniel, taught Phillips to read and write. She also learned Greek and Latin. The decision to allow an enslaved person an education meant the Wheatleys were considered progressive by their peers. Phyllis wrote her first poem at the age of 14 and traveled to England with Nathaniel in 1773, where she sought to publish a book of poems. England was thought to be more receptive to an educated African than Boston society. Her book of poems was published that year to great acclaim. Upon its publication, the Wheatleys emancipated Phyllis. Despite her positive reception in London, Phyllis supported the Patriot cause. In 1775, she sent her poem to His Excellency George Washington, to the general. He invited her to visit him, which she did in 1776. She married a free black grocer named John Peters in the late 1770s or early 1780s, the height of the American Revolution. In 1779, she attempted to publish a second volume of poetry, The American Revolution, and the death of John and Susanna Wheatley meant she was unable to secure enough subscribers to go to print. Her husband, John, was imprisoned for debt in 1784, and Phyllis was forced to find work as a scullery maid. She died on December 5th, 1784, at the age of 31. Her infant son died soon after.
Okay. Our next colonial woman is Mary Phyllis Philipse Morris. The middle daughter of Frederick Phillips II, Mary Phillips inherited nearly 50,000 acres of the Highland patent at age 22. Although she could not manage the property herself under British laws, her inheritance made her the wealthiest and most eligible young woman in New York and perhaps the entire 13 colonies. Although there is evidence that George Washington, then a young Virginia militia officer, was interested in her, she married retired British Army Colonel Roger Morris in 1758. George married Martha a year later in 1759. Mary and Roger built Mount Morris, a mansion overlooking the Harlem and Hudson Rivers in northern Manhattan in 1765. Today, it is known as the Morris Jumel Mansion. They enjoyed just over a decade at Morris House until war broke out. Roger Morris returned to England in 1775, and Mary joined her siblings at Philipse Manor Hall in Yonkers. In 1776, Morris House was used by George Washington as temporary headquarters after his loss at the Battle of Brooklyn Heights. Following the Battle of Harlem Heights, it became the headquarters of British General Sir Henry Clinton. In 1777, Mary and her siblings fled to New York City, where they remained for the duration of the war. She and her sister Susanna were some of the only women specifically named in the 1779 Act of Attainder, which confiscated all of their properties because they were loyalist. In the 1783, the Morrises fled to England. Because Roger and Mary had a prenuptial agreement, leaving her lands to their children, the Morrises had hoped to reclaim their lands in the Highland Patent, but were ultimately unsuccessful. Another of our colonial women is Elizabeth Caldliss. Elizabeth Caldliss is one of the few stories of enslaved people during the Revolution that we know a fair amount about. Liss was enslaved by the Townsend family in Oyster Bay, Long Island during the American Revolution. In 1778, the Townsend home became the headquarters of British commander Colonel John Graves Simcoe, who was an abolitionist. He helped Liss escape in 1779, but she was captured and re-enslaved by another British officer in New York City and remained there for the duration of the war. The Townsend son, Robert, became part of the Culper spy ring to assist George Washington in gathering intelligence on the British. When the British were set to evacuate in 1783, Liss asked Robert to help her stay in New York. She was sold to a woman who promised to keep her in Manhattan, but she sold Liss to Charleston, South Carolina, separating her from her 2-year-old son, who remained enslaved in New York. When Townsend discovered what had happened to Liz, he worked to try to free her, and she ultimately did gain her freedom. And our last colonial woman is Deborah Sampson. Deborah Sampson was born in Massachusetts in 1760. Abandoned by her father and placed with relatives by her mother, by 1770, Deborah was living as an indentured servant, which she remained until 1778. During that time, she learned to read and write, and once her indenture ended, she supported herself by teaching school, working as a weaver, and doing woodwork. Taller than most men at the time and plain-featured, in 1782, Deborah enlisted in the American Army as Timothy Thayer. But she enlisted in her hometown. She was outed by a local resident who recognized her and discharged upon returning what was left of her signing bonus. Undeterred, she tried again in a different town, this time enlisting under the name Robert Shirtliff. There, she joined an elite unit of light infantry, men chosen for being taller and stronger than average. She fought in several skirmishes before being wounded in her first battle on July 3rd, 1782, near Tarrytown. Although she begged not to be taken to a doctor, her compatriots ignored her. She dug at least one musket ball out of her own leg to avoid the doctor discovering her sex. The other remained in her leg for the rest of her life. While in Philadelphia, she contracted fever, and the local doctor discovered her secret. He sent her to his home to recover, nursed by women. And following the 1783 Treaty of Paris, the doctor finally revealed her sex to her commanding officer, who told her to go home, unpunished. She was honorably discharged by General Henry Knox at West Point. Following the war, she married a Massachusetts farmer and had 4 children and adopted a 5th. The farm was small and the soil poor. In 1792, she petitioned for her military pay, which had been withheld because she was a woman. Her pay was granted. In 1797, she published The Female Review, Life of Deborah Sampson, the Female Soldier in the War of the Revolution. And in 1802, went on a public speaking tour to talk about her experiences. Despite her success, the family still struggled to make ends meet. Her friend, Paul Revere, eventually wrote a petition advocating for Sampson to be awarded a military pension, which she had never received. In 1805, Congress approved her pension. She died of yellow fever in 1827. A decade later, her husband petitioned for benefits as the spouse of a veteran. Congress approved his request, but he died before the benefits could be collected. So we're going to end with a little run through of women's legal rights in New York and the United States from 1664 to 1974, because that is about how long it takes us to get back to the same legal rights that Dutch women had in New Netherland, right? And it's a lot, so I'm just going to run through really quickly, right? 1664, the British take over New York. In 1771, New York passes a law that husbands had to get their wife's consent to sell her property, which tells you that that was not the case before. 1789, we have the Constitution, which doesn't give women any rights, right? The word woman's not even in the Constitution. In 1800, New York passes gradual manumission, which frees nobody. But in 1827, we do get the end of legal slavery. The practice of slavery does continue thanks to gradual manumission until the 1840s. In 1845 in New York, women have the right to file patents, although that is mostly restricted to white women. We have our first women's rights conventions in New York in the 1740s. We have a Married Women's Property Act in New York in 1848, which allows women to retain their property in marriage. In 1850, Sojourner Truth gives her famous Ain't I a Woman speech in Ohio, which if you know anything about Sojourner Truth, that she did not actually speak with a Southern accent. She spoke Dutch, was her native language. 1865 is the end of the Civil War and the 13th Amendment. December 1865, New Jersey is the last state to ratify the 13th Amendment, and that is the official end of slavery in New Jersey. We get the 14th Amendment, and some women become citizens in 1867. We also have our first women's suffrage amendment in 1867, which is rejected. In 1871, Susan B. Anthony is arrested for voting. In 1917, although she couldn't vote for herself, technically, Jeanette Rankin is sworn into Congress as our first Congresswoman, I should say. The U.S. also enters World War I, and suffragette Alice Paul goes on a hunger strike that same year. In 1920, we get the 19th Amendment, which gives some women in the United States suffrage, not all, mostly white women. 1924, we get the Native American Citizenship Act, which declares that all indigenous people are, in fact, U.S. citizens, which gives many of them the right to vote. In the 1960s, women get the right to open their own bank accounts. Yes, the 1960s. 1963, we get the Equal Pay Act. 1964, the Civil Rights Act. 1965, the Voting Rights Act, which finally guarantees Native and Black women's rights to vote. 1972, we get Title IX, and then the Equal Rights Amendment goes to the states where it is not ratified, still not ratified to this day. And in 1974, we get the Equal Credit Opportunity Act, in which women can have credit cards without their husbands having to sign off on it. So, Margaret Hardenbrook had access to credit, property, could own her own business, do her own training, sue for divorce, all of these other things that it takes us a couple of centuries almost to get back to. So I just thought it was interesting to go through this list as we're talking about women in colonial New York and their rights. So our final slide is a little bibliography. This is being recorded, so you guys are welcome to do a screenshot. These are all also on our website, philipsmanorhall.com. There is a whole bibliography section, but these were some of the main books that Danna and I consulted for tonight's talk. So, any questions from either the audience here in the house or online? Michael, I saw we were getting some chats along the way, so Danna, you want to come up?
Can you share the source of the quote about how Margaret
Oh, that came from the book The Muncie Indians by Grumman?
Yep, Robert S. Grumman.
Robert S. Grumman.
This one right here.
Mm-hmm. And that's actually sold right here at our Philip Spencer Hall.
Yes, thank you, Donna. It's in our gift shop if anyone wants to buy it. And it was published in 2022, so it's quite a recent publication. Anybody else? Should we take a question from here in the audience?
Hi, Suzanne and Phil. It's Roberts. What's her last name?
Robinson.
Did she and her husband slave people up in Lehigh, Manhattan?
So the question was about Susanna Phillips Robinson. She and Beverly Robinson. Do they enslave anyone? I think the answer is yes, right, Michael?
Yes, Susanna. Yeah.
Yeah, so Beverly Robinson was from a Virginia planter background, so he grew up with enslaved people in his household, and I don't know, probably online you couldn't hear. Our site manager, Michael Lord, said that Susanna inherited at least two people from her father in his will. So yes, they did have enslaved people. Great question. Anybody else online? I see a lot of chats popping up as we're going here. We'll take another one from the in-person audience in the meantime. Yes, Terrell.
Question about We will call the Irish brands and the
You want to, or do you want me to?
You can.
If you guys can repeat the question.
Yes. So the question was about in Muncie and Haudenosaunee culture, is there any equivalent to modern day transgender identities? And yes, there was. Historically, a lot of indigenous communities have something they call two-spirit. Basically, a person who is born feeling both male and female gender. And often those people would be spiritual leaders in their communities. That was considered kind of a special gift to have both the masculine and feminine energies. And that's something that a lot of indigenous two-spirit people are trying to reclaim today, right? Because their communities have been colonized. And so they're bringing in this more European patriarchal perspective. And so they're trying to get back to their roots and how their communities would have traditionally dealt with that. Yes, Michael.
I would sort of like to know if there are any active Muncie tribe members still in New York.
Ooh, yes. Are there any active Muncie tribe members still in New York? Yes. The answer is yes. There is an organization in Manhattan called the Lenape Center that works with Lenape and Muncie communities in New York, New Jersey, Pennsylvania, that area. Most of our Lenape and Muncie communities are headquartered further west and also in Canada. You know, the federally recognized tribes are in Wisconsin, Kansas, and Oklahoma. There are also two recognized groups in Canada, one in Ontario. And the Stockbridge Muncie in Wisconsin in particular, we worked with on the new exhibits here at Philipse Manor Hall that we did get input from many of the federally recognized tribes. So the answer is yes. Yes, there are still people here. Many people did not leave or came back. So great question. Yeah.
The heart spirit of the best neighbor, and usually new scholars that who you are specifically. But this fellow is second mission. So everybody is going to find a good father and bless the heart spirit. It's at 7:30 in the morning at 55 Alexander Street, Evershell Park.
Okay, so that was Marcia was telling us that on Earth Day this year, 7:30 in the morning in Yonkers, where is it located? 35 Alexander Street, they have a ceremony where Lenape person comes to bless the Hudson River for Earth Day, and that is happening again this year on April 22nd, if anybody wants to check it out. All right, any other questions online? Michael, yeah, go ahead.
Our Parks colleague, Ben Melly, I could ask if we could say more about the slide showing the African.
Yes. We'll go away. Oh, I got to go backwards the hard way. All right, give me a second here. Can I get out of, yeah, we'll do it this way. Yes, that is a pretty iconic picture. I probably should have talked about it this. So this is, this question from Pam is about who is this woman in this slide? And this is the image of a woman who I think this is her name, Sidong Hongbe, and it says, an Amazon from the Dahomey Army, and it was published in a book called Dahomey and the Dahomeyans, being a journal of two missions to the King of Dahomey in two volumes by Frederick Edwin Forbes in 1851. This is an image that was digitized by the British Library. And is available on Wikipedia, which is where I found it. I love this image because, I mean, it's a 19th century image. A lot of images of enslaved people are 19th century images. It's very hard to find 18th century ones, so we have to do the best we can. But this is kind of the standardized outfit that they wore. She has a rifle or a musket. She has a knife here and a club, and she is holding the severed head of a man, right? That is to showcase her warrior culture and that she was actively engaged in war. So That's where that image comes from, Pam. All right. Anybody else? Anyone else online?
Kurt was asking if you knew more about the land north of Wall Street, what happened in that community?
You can maybe answer that one better than I can, Michael. So we have a question about what happens to the land of the blacks. I think they largely leave for New Jersey, yes?
Yeah,
that's true. Yeah. So there's that 1702 law that forbids African people in New York from inheriting lands, and that really kind of puts the kibosh on basically passing down that land through to their family members through inheritance. So
Hi, Kirk. I'm Mike. I'm here to answer that question a little bit. The land of the blacks, the land that was given to these first 11 arrivals and then later on other individuals, held pretty fast and true through the Dutch period of New Netherlands. When the English took over in 1665, they began to install laws that would restrict property ownership for persons of African descent. And as those laws grew more restrictive, those individuals in these lands, which really were right around where Greenwich Village and NYU is today, actually, many of them decided, as Sarah said, to leave that area of Manhattan and move across the Hudson River into Bergen County. Today, there's been some research done in and around the town of Paramus, New Jersey, where several of these families moved to, did maintain their land for a number of years, but by the early 1700s, the laws had grown so restrictive that most of those individuals had lost their land. There were several buildings that may have been ascribed to ownership by these persons of African descent over the years. The last one, I believe, was bulldozed less than 10 years ago. So there is no more physical evidence of any of those individuals in Manhattan or in New Jersey at this point. But there does seem to be a lot of research going on as to trying to follow through on the story of these individuals. Good question. Thank you.
All right, well, since you're up here, maybe we'll just stop sharing the screen. And so I can see the chat while we're here. See if there's anybody else who has questions. Does anybody else have questions in the audience besides Jerome? Let's give other people a chance too, Jerome. Yeah, go ahead, Marcia. What was the name of that?
Which town?
So the question was about Central Park. When Central Park was created, yeah, Seneca Village was, I think, an integrated community, right? Yeah, so that's in the 19th century, mid to late 19th century, there's this big urban park movement. And most of the cities don't just have wide open green spaces in the middle of the city already. So you have to eminent domain and bulldoze something in order to make a park. And in a lot of communities in New York, not just New York City, places like Albany, places like Newburgh, the, you know, city father said, hey, what's the least desirable part of town, usually where the poor or people of color live? And let's eminent domain it, bulldoze it, and we'll turn that into our park, right? So we're not going to disturb any of the wealthy white residents. We're going to take the most vulnerable population because they're the least able to fight back. So that's what happens with Seneca Village in New York City. It happens, I forget the name of the neighborhood in Albany, that happens to create like the capital district in Albany. It happens a lot, so. Oh yeah, that was Pinkster Hill? Wow, we might need to make a blog post about that too. So, all right, who am I missing on here? Okay, how many acres of land did the Philipse family own in total? It changes over the years, but the highest I think is like what, 250,000 acres?
Yeah, the 50,000 in Westchester and the 200,000 up at Clemson.
Yeah, it's about 52,000 in Westchester. It's like Kingsbridge to the Croton River, and then not quite to the Connecticut border. in Westchester County, and then all of Putnam County is about 200,000 acres. So.
Is it Captain's wife, Philipse, had some of the pensions in Chapman?
He had some small bits of land on the west side of the Hudson River around Blaufeld, in those areas. He used it as salt marshes, basically.
Okay. Any other questions in person or online? Terrell, you can ask your question now if you want to.
Okay. Well, before I get my question, I wanted to read this quote.
Okay. If you're going to read it, you have to come up here and read it so people online can hear you. Terrell is another one of our museum interpreters. So.
Hi, everyone. I'm going to read this quote for you. It's from a Mohawk Bear Clan mother. I cannot pronounce her name, so I won't. But she says, women are indeed the first environment. With our bodies, we nourish, sustain, and create connected relationships and interdependence. Earth is our mother. In this way, Earth is our mother. In this way, we as women are the Earth. And this is coming also from the creation myth of the Iroquois, where guy, woman descends to Turtle Island. And I'll sit.
No, I'm here.
Okay. Well, my question, it centers on, because we focus a lot here on trade, because this was a trading post. And also we have a game, the bird trading game, which is a success in my mind, because the children, they really learn how to negotiate. And they learned that the value of these items had no real set value unless the people gave them value. So that's the important lesson we try to iron out. But more to my point is, I got this quote from a book. It's newly released. It's called Gender, Trade, and Change Across Three Centuries. The title is called Shirts Powdered Red. And it's a book about three centuries of trade that centers on women and their relationship, indigenous women, and their relationship to, I guess, the market. And the opening chapter kind of blew me away, because usually when we focus on the story of enslavement in this house, we actually focus on Juan Rodriguez, who was not enslaved, right? He's an explorer, and he's pre the Dutch period of enslavement. And he is an interpreter. He's like set down on Governor's Island, and he is there primarily for the Dutch, right?
Yes.
The Dutch to translate indigenous culture to the Dutch. So in this chapter in the book, she's talking about a woman, she's either black or mulatto. She's either black or indigenous woman who comes to Iroquois land. And during the time of, I think it's corn season, so corn's in bloom and it's trading season. And she comes in, and she is not of Iroquois land, but they adopt her and she becomes Iroquois formally. And what's important about this woman is, this is upstate New York, and what's important about her is the time period where she comes. So she's coming in, I believe, the 1580s to around the 1600s. And the author of this book notes that she is the last generation, actually, of Iroquois women to dress without the influence of the Europeans.
Yeah.
So I find that fascinating that...
Sorry.
Okay. Well, that is my question, because usually we center on male discovery of... or explorers of... the early African period, but here's this woman who's literally swept into Iroquois land, adopted, and is actually one of the last people in this community to actually dress, and she's not of that community. So
yeah, so that's a lot of our indigenous cultures in New York, because so like they're matrilineal, right? And the Munsee in particular are matrilocal, which means that the men in the tribe are the ones who leave to marry into other groups. And so a lot of the tribal structure is family relationships through the women, right? And so the Munsee in particular have a history of basically good relations with a lot of their neighbors because a lot of the men in the community are coming in from the outside, right? They're coming into the Muncie community. I don't know if it's precisely the same with the Iroquois, but that was very common, right? It's not like today when the people in your village are, you're not related to all of them, right? But in a lot of indigenous communities across the world, not just here in North America, your village, you're related to a lot of people in your village. So if you don't want to have inbreeding and you want to maintain, you know, your genetics, you get people from the outside to come in and join your tribe or your group. So that's happening in Europe, it's happening in Africa, and it's happening particularly in Muncie country here in the Hudson Valley. So that does not surprise me that there is a woman coming into Iroquois and getting adopted in, because that was a very common practice. Okay. Any other questions? Looks like we may have a couple more online. Let me just check. Ooh, Melissa says, have you done any research to track modern descendants of the Philipse family's enslaved people? Michael, you want to take that one?
I don't have any information on it. Still not.
Yeah, we have definitely tracked some of the names of the enslaved. One of our research projects is to see if any, like what happened to the Philipse family's enslaved population after they leave in 1783. So it's on our list, but I'll let Michael talk maybe about, he knows more than I do, so maybe you know something I don't, but.
Unfortunately, I wish I did know anything else about this, but to the best of our knowledge, there has been as much research as I can think of being done here, but those ends don't lead us anywhere. There's been a lot of fires destroying a lot of records. It's excruciatingly difficult to trace lineages with enslaved individuals simply because so many did not have a last name recorded, so it made it very difficult, and so many were not listed in any type of records aside from the records of their enslavers. So it's been very difficult to get past the early 1800s, even with some records. I think as far back we can get to with Bett and a few other individuals that show up on the Phillipses as being wards of the state in the early 1800s, just before their death. If anybody does have any information out there, it would be greatly appreciated to be able to share that with us, because we would really love to learn more about any family descendants from Philipse Manor Hall or the individuals that were here. But right now, I don't have any information on that, and unless we can get some folks out there doing more genealogy, it's going to be really difficult to get that information.
Okay, Kirk says, gentrification and disruption of Black communities has a long history, very sad and still ongoing. From the lecture, this phenomenon appears to be rooted in a long culture and history. Yes, that is very true, Kirk. John, we are affiliated with Philipse Manor Hall, State Historic Site in Yonkers, which is where our in-person audience is today. So please come and visit us. You can find all our information on philipsemanorhall.com. That's Philipse, P-H-I-L-I-P-S-E, right? Yes, Empire State Plaza and Albany was the area that was bulldozed. Melissa, yes, we will send out the title of the book Terrell is talking about. What? Shirts, powder, and bread. Gender and trade in 3 centuries of gender and trade, something like that. Yep. Let's see here. Yep, okay, someone posted it for me already. Oh, Melissa. Melissa wants to help with the research, Michael. That would be fantastic, Melissa. Okay, any other questions? In person or online, any in-person questions?
Thank you.
All right, I think we can be done. Thank you so much, everybody, for joining us. I am going to stop recording. So folks online, our next lecture is actually with Michael. Yay, bye, Donna. On April 12th, yes, second Wednesday in April, it'll be in person here at Philipse Manor Hall or online. If you haven't signed up yet, you should. He's going to be talking a lot more in depth about Some of the insurrections and uprisings I covered briefly here today, and other methods of resistance from enslaved people in colonial New York. So I'm going to sign off online, folks, in-house. If you want to stay and chat, you can. And we'll see you next time. Good night, everybody.